In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit, amen. My Lord and my God, I firmly believe that you are here, that you see me, that you hear me. I adore you with profound reverence. I ask your pardon for my sins and the grace to spend this time of prayer fruitfully. My Immaculate Mother, Saint Joseph, my Father and Lord, my guardian angel, intercede for me. In those days, a great persecution arose against the church in Jerusalem, and they were all scattered throughout the region of Judea and Samaria, except the apostles. Devout men buried Stephen and made great lamentation over him. But Saul laid waste the church, and entering house after house, he dragged off men and women and committed them to prison. Now those who were scattered went about preaching the word. No servant is greater than his master. Our Lord had warned his disciples. So if they persecuted me, then they will also persecute you. If they have calumniated me, they will calumniate you. If they accuse me of being possessed by the devil, they will also accuse you of being possessed by the devil. I'm sure you have considered it sometime or another. It's one of the questions brought up in that theology course on salvation. Could God have saved us any other way than the way he did? And the answer to that is a resounding yes. God can do anything, everything, except a contradiction. God can make a square circle, for example, because that's a contradiction. Square has four corners, the circle doesn't have any. So it's a principle of non-contradiction, the most fundamental principle in metaphysics. So God could have saved us just wanting to, willing it, meaning to say forgiving us our sins, and even reconstituting fallen human nature to its original state. But no, because even if that would have been infinitely omnipotent and infinitely merciful, it wouldn't be just. And so therefore he wanted a redemption. Man somehow had to be part of the project. It's man who sinned, it's he who was offended. As far as he was concerned, he was willing to forego the offense. But the cause of it, the disobedience of man, had to be repaid by man. But the problem was, how can man repay something which is infinite in gravity? Because the gravity of an offense is not measured by the dignity of the offender, but by the dignity of the offended, and the offended is God, who is an infinite being. Then how can man possibly do anything? What can man do to make up for that offense? And the answer to that is none. And so God had to do it himself. But then again, we go back to the original problem of justice. And God found a solution. The second person of the Blessed Trinity at the given moment in history takes our nature, becomes man like us, so that he could suffer as man on behalf of mankind, but meriting as God, because he is God. And when we consider that, then we realize that if God chose that way, a way of suffering for himself, a way of sacrifice for himself, then he, in fact, established the rules of engagement for our own sanctification and our own co-redemption, our own apostolic work. that it will have to pass through the cross. It will have to pass through sacrifice. It needs to pass through immolation, self-giving. And then we go full circle. But isn't that really what God is? Because God is love, and love is self-giving. That human nature is fulfilled in our giving ourselves. And the supernature, which is our participation in God in a supernatural way through the indwelling of the Blessed Trinity in us when we are in the state of grace, also has to be like that, because that's just the, shall we say, we're all very familiar with the idea of upsizing. When you upsize an order at McDonald's, for example, that our supernatural life is just an upsizing of our natural life to a certain extent. We're made in the image of God, and we're elevated to the likeness of God because of the indwelling of the Blessed Trinity in us. And so therefore, if God is love, then we too must be love. Our fulfillment is loving. And that's what we see immediately in the life of the early church. Self-giving. That is, that the persecution arose. Of course, it had to arise. If they persecuted our Lord, they would persecute them, which scattered them first in Palestine, out of Jerusalem, because the first disciples, the first converts were in Jerusalem as a result of the preaching of Saint Peter soon after Pentecost. Many were converted, thousands. But then that persecution arose, and so they had to scatter outside of Jerusalem, throughout Judea, and spilling over to Samaria. And this is what we read today. Philip went down to a city of Samaria and proclaimed to them the Christ. And the multitude, with one accord, gave heed to what was said by Philip when they heard him and saw the signs which he did. For unclean spirits came out of many who were possessed, crying with a loud voice, and many who were paralyzed or lame were healed. So there was much joy in that city. Remember that Samaria had fallen into idolatry. Not totally their fault, because of the Babylonian exile, the priestly class, the learned class, the Pharisees, the Sanhedrin, the priests, the Levites, were hauled off to Babylon. And these were the intelligentsia belonging to Judea, the region around Jerusalem. And so in the plains of Samaria, they were left to their own devices for 80 years during the exile. And so they had to fend for themselves. And a thought comes to my mind, my brothers and sisters, how well Jesus Christ thought or configured the church for everyone to participate in the priesthood of Christ. Because of baptism, there has to be a priestly class, the ordained ministers, who not only configured to Christ's priesthood as the character of baptism, share in his role as head. In persona Christi capitis is the formula in Latin. In the person, they stand in the person of Christ as head in the church. Without them, there can be no mystical body of Christ. And that's what happened, mutatis mutandis, to the people of Samaria at that time. They lost their leaders, they lost their priests, they lost their scribes, and so left to their own devices, they soon fell to idolatry, the religion of the surrounding tribes, the non-Israelites. And that's where Philip went to evangelize. And he had big success, great success, because he worked out miracles, he healed the sick. But most of all, because of what they were telling them. They believed in what he was saying. Again, let's think about this. Christianity is not an esoteric body of doctrines that are unbelievable. On the contrary, Christianity is what has the explanation for everything. It is said that Edith Stein, that famous German philosopher during the early part of the 20th century, who, being a woman, nevertheless won a cathedra teaching in the university, very unusual at that time. It was a singular thing, as a matter of fact. She was a Jew, a Jewess. And one day, she read the New Testament, the Gospels. And she read it from cover to cover, all in one go, one night. And by sunrise, she said, "Das ist die Wahrheit. That is the truth." She converted. She became a Christian, I mean a Catholic. She became a nun. And she was martyred during the Nazi occupation, because she had fled northwards to Belgium. Christianity is believable. Not only is it believable, it's the thing that ties up all the loose ends of all the other learnings and even the natural sciences. The physical sciences can only go so far, beyond which there's no evidence. Look at the origin of man, for example. How can any science possibly have an explanation of the origin of man? Because nobody was there to witness it. We have belabored so many times. The so-called theory of evolution is not even a theory, it's a hypothesis. And it can never be proven, because the only way to prove it is if you, in fact, generate a species from another species. And that has never been done. Much less that man evolved from inferior forms. But it's a very interesting hypothesis. And when you read sacred scripture, Genesis, then you realize, yeah, it was like that. Because it said there that God made man, not created man from nothing. He made him, specifying even from the slime of the earth, meaning to say from inferior forms, even from inanimate forms, from the slime. But of course, from slime to Adam, that's a big leap. There must have been an evolution there. And that's exactly what the apostles were now teaching. But not that, because that was already taught by Abraham, rather by Moses. But rather, the fulfillment of all that process of Project Mankind, as I keep on calling it, with the coming of Jesus Christ and his passion, death, and resurrection, especially the resurrection. And so they were converted. He had big success. But there was a man named Simon who had previously practiced magic in the city and amazed the nation of Samaria, saying that he himself was somebody great. They all gave heed to him, from the least to the greatest, saying, "This man is that power of God which is called great." And they gave heed to him, because for a long time he had amazed them with his magic. But when they believed Philip, as he preached good news about the kingdom of God and the name of Jesus Christ, they were baptized, both men and women. Even Simon himself believed. And after being baptized, he continued with Philip, and seeing signs and great miracles performed, he was amazed. Fast forward to the present. Then we find these scientists who have constituted themselves as wise, the oracles, the gurus of our present age. Nobel Prize winners, some of them. Great chemists, mathematicians, anthropologists, paleontologists, trying to explain away the faith, claiming that they can explain everything, that there's no need for God, there's no need for revelation. Isn't this what happened with Simon? He was a magician. A magician was just not really just somebody who fooled the people. Normally, the magicians of old were alchemists. They knew a bit of the physical sciences, more than what the normal people, the ordinary people knew. And so therefore, they could perform tricks, which the ignorant people ascribed to superpowers. But actually, they were just physical sciences. But all of these scientists who are atheists, they're modern-day Simons, modern-day magi, modern-day imposters. Just remember I told you before that atheism is not an intelligent position. The intellect of man left to its own devices, if not shackled by a vitiated will, which in turn is influenced by, shall we say, disordered passions. If the intellect were totally free, confronting the reality around him, around it, arrives at a certain knowledge of the existence of God. And if a person were really pure of heart with that knowledge of God, the next step is religion, the search of the true God. And that's the reason why religion has always been the mark of civilization. Everywhere that you have civilization, there has always been the religious phenomenon, a representation of the deity. Even in the caves of Altamira, they find this. Those prehistoric scrawlings or paintings on the walls of those caves, one of them is a representation of the deity, what those primitive people understood as God, the supreme being. But there will always be people who would want to justify, to rationalize, not only their own mediocrity, but their own misery. And we are all miserable because of our fallen nature. But instead of acknowledging God and opening oneself to revelation, because God precisely has revealed himself, not only naturally, but through sacred scripture, sending the prophets one after the other, and finally in the fullness of time, second person of the Blessed Trinity became flesh and preached and performed miracles and established the church and the sacraments. If in the face of all that revelation, somebody still resisted, it's because he wants to. And why should he want to? Why should a person confronted with the revelation of God want to refuse it? And that's where that statement of mine comes from. That atheism is always sinful. There's no such thing as an innocent atheist, an honest mistake. Not anymore. That was possible before when people didn't hear about the gospel. But now everybody knows, especially with the internet. So to persist in denying God, in denying Jesus Christ, there is a hidden, an ulterior motive. And the ulterior motive is self-affirmation, self-justification, the rationalization of a wrong position. But there will always be people like that. So what do we do? Condemn them? Fight them? Kill them like what they tried to do during the Inquisition? By the way, that Inquisition thing, that was not an invention of the church. Again, that's one of the lies, the calumnies foisted by those people trying to discredit the church because they had their own agenda. So there's always an agenda. Anybody who attacks the church, there is an agenda because he wants to rationalize his own position. Well, we cannot do that. So what do? We do apostolate. We drown evil with an abundance of good. We shed light on the confusion. We clarify the errors That's what revelation means. To push aside the veils of ignorance, the veils of error. Drown error with an abundance of truth. And we can never stop doing this. Because the devil is always active. And he will always sow division, confusion. That's the reason why, for those of you who are reading up on these things, you have Catholic sources bent on churning out conspiracy theories that there are evil forces working in the church, etc. Of course, there will always be evil forces. The devil is active. Remember that even Jesus Christ, of the 12 apostles, one, that's 8%, was Judas. So the fact that there are people who are speaking badly of the Pope, or there are bishops and definitely priests who have done wrong things, there will always be bad apples in the barrel. But it doesn't make the whole barrel. That doesn't make all apples bad. Yes, there was one Judas, and even now there are Judases. The figure of Judas is very clear, it is very real. But precisely, those are the Judases. And they will have their reckoning, as Judas had his. So what do? We stick to the course. We listen to our pastors. And my Lord, you made it so clear. You established the church. You establish the sacraments, and you made that promise. The gates of hell shall not prevail against it. And behold, I'm with you up to the end of the earth. We have to end. These considerations, especially at this stage of this, first it was just the corona retreat, and then you had the crossing the desert, and now we are in this series of meditations which we have entitled No Greater Love, which, as I told you, we try to bring all the way up to Pentecost. But we're approaching Pentecost. And so at this stage, we should be already maturing into being able to do this prayer on our own. But before we reach that part, it's now important to identify what are the principles, the elements of the construction, of the edifice of our own sanctification that we'll have to do. Not on our own, because that's always the initiative, the action of the Holy Spirit in our soul in grace, but actively collaborating with the divine artist who's trying to make out of each one of us, from that raw marble, Carrara marble, that each one of us, the image of Jesus Christ, whittling away, not just whittling away, hammering away the extra pieces until what is left is Jesus Christ. Well, let's formulate this one principle, which is that the church is not our invention. It's not a human invention. It's the initiative of the Blessed Trinity. Specifically, it was instituted by Jesus Christ, forming the apostles, leaving behind the sacraments, animated by the Holy Spirit who comes on Pentecost, and which then becomes Christ's presence in the history of mankind, although until the end of time. All the elements are there. You and I are the pieces. You and I are the protagonists. We're not kibitzers. Let's never be kibitzers in our own, or fence sitters in our own sanctification. Sanctity is very, very personal. You and I, we have to craft out our own sanctity by dint of struggling daily, cooperating with the Holy Spirit, being quick to rectify. This is Simon the magician did, because Simon started to, from observing Philip, started to confection the sacraments also, at least the sacramentals, but collecting a fee. After all, that was his profession before that. He performed magic for a fee. until it was corrected by Philip, and he rectified immediately, asking for forgiveness. All of us, we can make mistakes. And we will, we have, as a matter of fact, and we will continue doing so. But if we're humble, then we will detect the stirrings of the Holy Spirit in our soul. And we will say sorry, and we will mend our ways. You have 5 minutes left to finish the prayer.